Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the COVID-19 webinar organized by the National Institute for Occupational Health. And today's topic is workplace risk assessment, cleaning, decontamination, storage, and transportation. And we have important colleagues of mine who are specialized in these fields presenting with us today on these topics. I'm going to quickly hand over to the chairperson of the COVID-19 Occupational Health Outbreak Response Team, the OHOT team, Dr. Tanusha Singh, just to do the welcome to our session today. Over to you, Tanusha.
Thank you very much, Ashraf. Colleagues, friends, greetings to everyone. On behalf of the National Institute for Occupational Health, a division of the National Health Laboratory Services, a very warm welcome to you all to this webinar. It's really wonderful to see so many of you joining us. We are really delighted to have this webinar today, which covers risk assessments, as Ashraf has mentioned. The risk assessments are the foundation of any preventative strategy. So we anticipate, evaluate, and respond to risks and hopefully in a more proactive way rather than a reactive manner as we are accustomed to. So it's really great that our colleagues will be presenting to you on this. So I'd like to, on that note, welcome the presenters from NIOH who are familiar faces on the webinar. We have Mr. Gabriel Mizan, Ms. Dikeledi Matuka, and Dr. Charlene Andreas. Welcome, colleagues, and thank you for availing yourselves and sharing your knowledge with all of us. To all the participants today, we acknowledge how busy you all are, and we are really very appreciative of you being here. We trust that you will have a very informative session, and you know that the information shared with you will assist you with your decision-making moving forward. May you have a productive session, and do take care. Over to you, Ashraf.
Thank you very much. That's Dr. Tanusha Singh, who is also the head of the immunology and microbiology section here at the NIH, in her capacity as the chairperson of the NIH's COVID-19 Occupational Health Outbreak Response Team, the COVID-19 OHOT team. I thank her for doing the welcome for today's webinar. I think this is the 71st or 72nd webinar that we are doing, and we are glad to be able to share the information regarding risk assessment, cleaning, decontamination, storage, and transportation with all of you today. And as Dr. Singh has indicated, on the principles of workplace health risk assessment, Gabriel Mizan will be dealing with that, and he is from our occupational hygiene section here at the NIH. And then that's followed by the risk assessment tools topic, and that's done by Dikeledi Matuka, and she is based in our immunology and microbiology section here at the NIH. And then the third and final topic is cleaning and disinfecting in different workplace settings, including storage and transportation, and that's by Dr. Charlene Andreas, who's part of our toxicology and biochemistry section here at the National Institute for Occupational Health. And we are part, a division of the National Health Laboratory Services. And so without much ado, let me first, before I hand over to my colleague, Gabriel Mizan, I need to just remind all of you who have logged on for this particular session, please do not use the raised hands function. I see that 9 colleagues have already indicated they've raised their hands. If you could please lower your hand, the raised hand function is not possible with such large numbers of attendees. And I will remind you later on if you've not yet. There seems to be more people adding their raised hands there. That's a bit concerning after having asked you not to raise your hands. Secondly, please, if you need to raise something, type it in the chat box. And in the chat box, we will respond to you with regard to any admin and general aspects that you want to deal with, and that's in the chat box only. If you have questions for our presenters related to the content of their presentations, please type that in the question and answer box. So let me repeat that for you. general comments, general aspects and admin in the chat box. If you have questions specific to the content of our presentation, our presenters' presentations and slides, that is in the question and answer box. And there we can answer you by typing the answers there. So your hands raised function is not going to work, as well as your microphone is not active for the session with such large numbers of people. Back to our topic, COVID-19, workplace risk assessment, cleaning, decontamination, storage, and transportation. Our first speaker is Gabriel Mizan. I'm going to ask Gabby just to share his video and check his audio. And Gabby is dealing with the principles of workplace health risk assessment. And while Gabby's preparing that, I just need to quickly find my official bio sketch for Gabby. One moment, I thought I had it open. My apologies for the delay, Gabby. So Gabby is in the field of occupational hygiene for more than 30 years, and his current roles in occupational hygiene at the NIH includes training and consultancy services, workplace hazard and exposure evaluations, health risk assessments, as well as managing the asbestos laboratory with the occupational hygiene section at the NIH. So Gabby's responsible for counting all those fibers when all the, I hope I've got that right, and Gabby can correct me if I'm wrong there, in running the asbestos laboratory here at the NIH. He has a master's in public health in occupational hygiene from Wits University, and is registered as an occupational hygienist with the Southern African Institute for Occupational Hygiene, generally called SIOH, since 2000. Published several articles related to the topic of asbestos, occupational noise, and reproductive health in pathology service laboratories. And with that very brief introduction, there's much more I can say. I hand over to my colleague, Gabby, to do our first presentation. Over to you, Gabby. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Ashraf. I hope you can hear me and see my slides.
Perfectly. Thank you, Gabby. Please proceed.
Okay. Thank you, Ashraf, and good morning, everyone. Really the topic that I would like to cover in my presentation is the principles of workplace health risk assessment. And really what I'm trying to do is setting the scene for the next presentations, which will be more specific about a risk assessment tool for hazardous biological agents, and particularly we're talking about COVID. This presentation will be more covering the principles, the basic principles of health risk assessment, although the focus would be more on hazardous biological agents, because that's what we're dealing with at this time. So I want to start with a little exercise, and let's see if that can work. So here are some causes of death in South Africa. What I would like you to try and do is look at this list, and if you can rate them, in other words, to put on top the one thing that you think is more serious, is causing more deaths, and then rate them from the more serious one to the less serious one. But because we don't have that much time, what I would like you to list is maybe the three top ones. So the first one, which you think is the highest, and then number two and number three. And if you can put this in the chat box, so we're not gonna wait for everybody to do that, but maybe we'll get three or four responses and take it from there. So, I'm just trying to see if I can see the chat. Okay, I can see TB, COVID-19. Okay, murder, MVA, COVID-19, murder, accident, TB, heart disease, stroke. Okay, guys, I think that's enough. I think we're not going to be able to read all the answers. Thanks very much for this. And let me try and see if I can go to my next slide. So this was sort of published. I've got a big warning at the bottom because it was from social media. But this was in April, exactly 1 year ago. And I think this is pretty accurate, at least in terms of the COVID-19 cases. We had like 3 cases in a day, three fatalities from COVID-19. So there had the other causes that you've mentioned were much more sort of significant than COVID-19. And what does that actually telling us about risk? So it tells us a few things. First of all, that we tend to rate risk differently. As you could see, we not all of us gave the same answer. That means that we tend to perceive risk in a different way. And it depends on what we know, on our experience, maybe on our history. You know, when I ask people to rate all of those causes, I get very surprised because sometimes people put like almost on top, they put things like dog bite or lightning strike. And this is maybe because they had experience with those kind of things and they view it in a very serious manner. But the other thing that we can learn from this little exercise is that risk is not something that remains the same the whole time. Risk can change over time. So risk assessment is not something that we do like a once-off thing. We have to look at risk in a continuous basis all the time because the conditions change. So in April we had in 2020, we had like three fatalities from COVID on a daily basis. And then we've seen days where we had a few hundreds. And I think now more or less we're standing maybe on 50 a day. So this is much more serious than we thought it was. So this is the other lesson that we take from this. You know, risk doesn't remain the same. And when we do a risk assessment, we also have to try and project the risk. In other words, we need to think, what will be the risk in the future? Maybe now it's low, but if we leave it, maybe in a few months' time, it can be out of hand and so on. So this is what I actually wanted to demonstrate. So what is a health risk assessment? It's basically an information gathering and review process that leads to a valid and informed judgment about health hazards and risks. So we want to have an informed decision. We're talking about COVID-19 or we're talking about anything else. We want to get all the facts and all the information that we can before we can assess the risk. It also helps us to take steps to achieve and maintain adequate control. So why actually we're doing the risk assessment? Because we want to mitigate the risk. We want to reduce it. We want to control it. And risk assessment is also helping us in making decisions about workplace monitoring and also all kinds of health surveillance programs that we are going to put in place. And I want to highlight two concepts that are very important in terms of risk assessment. And this is the difference between hazard and risk. You know, people are sometimes get confused about these two, and I'm also sometimes get confused, but it's important that we understand that there is a difference. So What is a hazard? A hazard is the capacity or potential to cause harm. It relates to intrinsic properties of a process or material, and it tends to remain the same. The hazard is the same. So let's think about COVID-19. What is causing COVID-19? It's a virus, which is called SARS coronavirus 2. Okay, it's always the same thing. And now it causes a certain type of symptoms, a certain type of disease with the flu-like symptoms and so on, and it affects the lung. So that much we know, but the risk of exposure to that hazard is always changing. It's not the same. So risk is the likelihood or the probability that harm will actually take place. And this depends very much on the circumstances. It varies all the time. That's why we need to do a risk assessment. When we talk about hazardous biological agents, there are different groups, which includes animals, plants, and microorganisms. But we are really interested in that group, in the microorganisms, which are bacteria, viruses, and fungi. These are the most important microorganisms that we are concerned with. Okay, so in terms of the hazardous biological agents regulations, we have four different groups of hazardous biological agents, and the grouping of those organisms depend on if they likely to cause a disease, how serious is that disease in human, is there any effective treatment, how likely it is to spread in the community. So these are the criteria for classification. And you know, when I was presenting last time about this, I've put SARS-CoV-2, which causes COVID-19, in group number 4, because if we look at the criteria, it causes serious human disease. We all know that. There is a high risk of spreading into the community. And at that time, there wasn't really available any treatment. Now we've got the vaccine. So perhaps we can move the SARS-CoV-2 into group 3. It is still causing serious human disease. It can still spread in the community, but at least maybe we have some kind of a treatment. So when it comes to prioritizing a risk, okay, perhaps we have different risks and we want to focus our attention on the ones that are more serious. How are we going to compare one risk to another? How are we going to rate them? There are two things that are very important. One is the severity or the consequences of exposure. So if I'm getting exposed to this particular agent, what will be the consequences? So this is one thing. The other thing is how probable it is that I'm going to be exposed, or what is the frequency of exposure? And these are the two things that are actually creating the risk, the health hazard and the exposure, those two things. And there are different ratings for this. And in the next presentation, we're gonna focus more about, particularly about COVID-19. But just in general, for example, if we're looking at the health effect, there are different ways of rating them. But this is one example. So we can look at, say, the highest scoring is for something that is life-threatening or causes disabling injury or illness. And then on the bottom of that rating would be something which is negligible, which causes reversible effect of little concern, and so on. So we rating the health hazard on the one hand, and then we also need to look at the exposure. Like I said, the other part of the equation is what is the frequency, what is the level of exposure? Is it very high or is it low exposure? So we have those two things that we need to put into our equation in order to get the risk. And there are different ways of plotting it. And this is just one example. On the one axis, we've got the health hazard rating. And on the other axis, we've got the exposure or the frequency or likelihood that we are going to be exposed to this agent. So if, for example, we're looking at COVID-19 and I'm sitting here in my office and nobody is around, what are the chances that I'm going to get exposed to COVID-19? I'm probably gonna be very low. But the health hazard, the COVID-19 hazard remains the same. So we're probably going to rate it as 4 or 5 because it causes death. It's very dangerous. So the combination of the two, let's say the very low and the high, I'm going to still be in the green or perhaps even in the yellow. But if we're looking now, for example, at the healthcare worker, a 65-year-old employee who's working with patients, then obviously he's going to be at much higher risk. So the exposure risk is going to be high, and the health hazard is going to be high as well. So he's going to sit on a high risk. And so similarly, we can also do something looking particularly at employee risk groups. So if we're looking at this healthcare worker, for example, he's obviously gonna be at a high or very high risk. And if that particular healthcare worker is also diabetic, something like that, he's gonna be vulnerable as well. So he's going to be sitting at a very high exposure risk compared to if we're looking at a young employee who's fit and healthy, he's going to be sitting somewhere there. But we're going to discuss it more in our next presentation. So in terms of the basic steps in conducting a health risk assessment, these are really similar to any occupational health hazard that you encounter. It can be COVID, it can be noise, it can be chemicals, anything like that. We first have to identify the agent and assess the hazard, how serious it is if we are exposed to this particular agent or chemical or physical agent, whatever it is. We have to look at what activities and processes are happening in that kind of environment. What are the employees engaging in? Are they working with patients, or are they in the office, or are they at home, or whatever it is? Then there is a process of prioritizing the risk, like we've seen. We look at the different risk, we look at the health hazard, we look at the what would be the consequences of exposure and what is the frequency and level of exposure. And based on that, we prioritize the different risks. Then what do we do about it? Okay, once we've categorized the different risks and we found which ones are higher and which ones are lower, what are we going to do about it? What control measures are we going to put in place to reduce, to mitigate, to control that risk. And like we've said already more than once, this is a continuous process. We need to reevaluate, we need to review, and it's a cyclical process. It never ends. There's always room for improvement, and conditions always change. So we always have to reassess. Another important concept to remember when we're talking about occupational health is the hierarchy of control. So the hierarchy of control means that the best method to mitigate or control a risk is prevention. Okay, prevention is better than cure. Prevention, elimination, substitution. If you can take whatever is causing a problem out from the equation, if we just for example with noise, okay, if we take that noisy equipment where there is no exposure, or if we can replace it with something which is doesn't make a noise, then we have prevented, then we eliminated the problem. There is no issue anymore. But often this is difficult. Often we can't do that. So then the next best step is some kind of engineering controls. It can be something like ventilation, automation, all those kind of things that we can do in terms of engineering to try and mitigate and control and reduce the risk as much as we can. Then we have administrative controls. And what are administrative controls? These are things like training workers, safe operating procedure, access control, signage, all those kind of things are administrative controls. And then the last resort is the personal protective equipment. So why do we say the last resort? Because personal protective equipment is very problematic. It depends on the workers actually taking the initiative to use the mask or whatever protective equipment they're getting, use it in the correct way, use it all the time, not half the time. So all those things are very difficult to actually control in the work environment. And therefore we'd like to try and reduce and eliminate and take out the risk in other ways than using personal protective equipment. Often there is no other way, as we know. We sometimes must use PPE, but we all know that the effectiveness of this is quite actually limited. So when it comes to hazardous biological agents, another term that is often used is the chain of infection. Okay, we need some kind of a process of a chain from the pathogen, from that agent that is causing the disease, and all the way to the host, to that person or animal or whatever it is that is now developing the disease. And if we can come up with some kind of control measures along that chain of infection, if we can break the chain anywhere, then the infection is not going to happen. Of course, it's good to try and do that early in the process, as earlier as possible, rather than at the last last part of the process of the chain. But anywhere that we can break the chains, either by engineering control, work practices, protective equipment, or maybe immunization now, then that can help us to sort of eliminate the problem. I would like to mention a few regulations that apply to hazardous biological agents risk assessment. And the first and maybe most important one that we have is the hazardous biological agents regulations. They are not new, and they are still very much applicable today. And we are now in the process of updating and reviewing those regulations. In fact, they already went out to public comments and probably will be promulgated quite soon. But this is still our yardstick. These are our comprehensive regulations to do with hazardous biological agents. Now, with the COVID-19 pandemic, the Department of Health and the Department of Employment and Labor came up with some directive to actually assist us to do risk assessment, particularly for COVID-19. And so this is one of them, specialized health risk assessment for workplaces. And I'm not gonna go through the whole thing, but just a few things to highlight is, first of all, the participation that is needed. So when we do a health risk assessment, is not one person is doing it in isolation, but we need to involve the workers, the management, and also the representatives, the health and safety reps, and so on. The risk assessment must cover things like the nature of work processes and activities, the nature and route of potential exposure to this kind of virus, who might be exposed, how are they, can they be exposed, and what are the control measures that are currently in place? And what happens if those control measures fail or don't work properly? So those are the kind of things that we need to cover. Another thing that is addressed in this particular directive is, for example, the question, who is a competent person to do this risk assessment? And the regulations of this directive is telling us that this person needs to be familiar with that risk assessment process. They need to know the regulations. They also need to be familiar with the hazardous biological agents in particular. And so who's that person? The regulation doesn't tell us who's that person, but it can be a person, any person in the company that is familiar with those processes, but preferably it can, at least when we do it, the first risk assessment, not the reviewing that comes maybe later, but the initial risk assessment, it's better if we get advice from a professional or a registered occupational hygienist. It can be a safety professional. Then in terms of control, again, this directive is talking about this important point of the hierarchy of control. And for biological agents like SARS-CoV-2, we have the standard precautions like that we all know, hand washing, sanitizing, social distancing, PPE, which is our mask. And then for laboratory, especially, we have the transmission-based precautions which are related to droplets, aerosol generation. You know, if we come in contact with the virus or if it's airborne, so we have transmission-based precautions. And then also, it's important to know when we need to review the assessment. So again, it's an ongoing process. So if we see that the current assessment that we did is no longer valid, it's the time that we need to review it. If something in the work environment has changed, okay, the methods, the equipment, the procedure, that's another good reason to review our risk assessment. If we have cases, you know, of COVID-19, that's a red light. That is indicating something is not working. We need to, again, do a risk assessment. And like I said initially, and I'm going to say it again, it's an ongoing process. It never ends. It's something that we need to come back to on a periodical basis. This is another directive that came out in May 2020. And this is a very practical, very good tool for COVID-19 risk assessment. And it's called COVID-19 walkthrough risk assessment. And what is the purpose of this particular directive? To assess the risk of exposure to SARS-CoV-2 at workplaces, assess the effectiveness of existing control measures, also to inform the employer or the employees of the potential risk and additional controls that that might be required. Again, we're coming back to this issue of control. This directive is really a checklist. It's an elaborate checklist that cover all those things that I've listed here on my slide, from education, training and awareness, to hygiene measure, to social distancing, to engineering controls, administrative, PPE, safe work practices, waste management, safety equipment, emergency response. So all those topics have got questions or a checklist that we can answer yes, no, not applicable, and also comment. So I encourage you to if you want to do a risk assessment, this is a very practical tool that you could use. The presenter after me, Dikeledi, is also going to show a comprehensive tool that is very practical and that you can use. In terms of the areas that we need to look at, so there are areas that are more higher risk. So for example, the entry and exit point from the workplace, places like change houses, canteen, dining areas, waiting areas, conference, training areas, any areas where we have people getting together, this is where there is more risk, more chances of transmission of infection. And we need to focus on those areas when you do the risk assessment. So I want to add my presentation just by listing a few issues, a few problems that we have with the hazardous biological agents risk assessment. And this is not just for SARS-CoV-2, but any hazardous biological agents that we have in our work environments, what kind of limitations of issues we have. So the one important thing to remember is that there is no threshold or no safe level of exposure. Okay, so there is a dose response relationship. In other words, the higher the dose we expose to, the higher the risk. But there is no a level which we can say, okay, like with chemicals, you know, with chemical exposure, we can say if we are exposed below a certain level, we are relatively safe. But with biological agents that can propagate, there's one organism can cause a disease and one organism can create another 2,000 or million organisms. So there's no level like an occupational exposure limit. There's no exposure limits for biological agents. They are common in the environment. Okay, bacteria, viruses, fungi are present anywhere in the environment. So it's not like chemicals that we know, okay, we encounter lead when we do work with lead or whatever. With biological agents, they are present everywhere. There are some uncertainties about the routes of exposure and their significance. So we don't really know, for example, the exposure that can come through contact. how serious it is compared to another route like inhalation. There are still a lot of uncertainties around that ingestion and all those other routes of exposure. A very important thing to consider when we're doing the risk assessment, and Micheletti is going to discuss that further, is about vulnerable workers and individual susceptibility. So we know it intuitively that not every person responds in the same manner when we get exposed. And we know that people that are have comorbidities and are already immunocompromised, they can be more susceptible when we get exposed to exactly the same conditions. And the last thing is the limitation in terms of the resources that we have for risk mitigation. And that's something that we also know, okay? The limitations in terms, for example, now the vaccines, they're not all of a sudden available to everyone. You know, the PPE, ventilators, whatever, we have limited resources, and that's another thing that we have to consider. Okay, guys, so I want to add with a question, and maybe you can put your answers in the chat box. I just want you to give me one short answer. It can be even one word if you want, or a few words. Why do we need to do a risk assessment? So let's hear from you. One or two words or three words. And I'm opening my chat box. Prevention of hazard, mitigate risk, reduce risk, to control, legal requirements, to evaluate the possible, determine safety, mitigate. Great, guys. That's exactly why we're doing it. And this is my word. If you ask me for one word, this is my word, to control. And that's what you say: mitigation, elimination, reduce, and control. Thanks very much for your attention, and enjoy the rest of this webinar.
Thank you very much. That was Gabriel Mazan. Thank you, Gabby, for taking the time out of your busy schedule to share your knowledge and experience with us. And I think for me, the take-home message, in addition to control, is break the chain of infection as early as Absolutely. Possible. Thank you, Gabby.
Absolutely.
And that is Gabby having dealt with the principles of workplace health risk assessment. I now introduce you to our second speaker. And this speaker will be dealing with risk assessment tools. And she is Micheletti Matuka from our immunology and microbiology section. And by way of introduction, while she's checking her slide and audio, Onika Matuka is a senior medical scientist at the National Institute for Occupational Health. That's the NIH. Micheletti's major research interests are bioaerosols and infectious diseases in the field of occupational health, with specific focus on microbiological indoor air quality, infection control, and prevention strategies for occupational exposures to hazardous biological agents. And COVID-19 SARS-CoV-2 is definitely a biological agent, a bug that's affecting us both in our communities, our country, and in our workplaces. Micheletti is a registered medical biological scientist with the Health Professional Council of South Africa, the HPCSA, under the discipline microbiology. She's an active member of the NIH Research Committee, and Micheletti was also a member of the Ultraviolet Germicidal Irradiation, that is UVGI, task team from 2010 to 2012. She's also involved in occupational health research training of undergraduate, postgraduate, and occupational health professionals. Micheletti has 18 years experience of occupational health, has presented at scientific forums, seminars, conferences, both nationally, internationally, and has published in different peer-reviewed journals. and as well as contributing significantly to this online webinar series by the NIH. With that short introduction, I say thank you very much, Tikaledi, for joining us. I can see your slide are maximized. If we can just test your microphone and audio is okay. Please proceed.
Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, thank you, Tikaledi. Please proceed.
Okay, thank you, Ashraf. Basically, I'm just gonna follow up on Gabby's presentation, but the focus here is on the biorisk assessment tool. I just want to mention that this is just a generic tool to give you guidance and to highlight the main aspects of which we should be looking at when conducting risk assessment. So there are other quantitative tools which are sector specific. So I'm sure you all have different tools that you already using in your respective workplaces. Okay, so this is basically just a mind map of the critical aspects that we should be looking at when we conduct risk assessment. So before risk assessment is done, one has to anticipate the risks, and then that will be followed by the identification of the source of exposure. In this case, it's your SARS-CoV-2, which is causing COVID-19. That's your agent. And the indirect exposures will be the sources that are infected with the virus, such as your body fluids or surfaces or even objects and materials that can be contaminated with agents. So from identifying your source or agent, then you look at the transmission pathway. This is the mode of transmission on how the virus enter into one's body. So we get different types of transmission routes when it comes to this virus. It can either be through respiratory droplets or direct contact with the infectious person, as well as airborne transmission. It is very important to understand the transmission route, because this will inform you on what control measures needs to be put in place. Because for contact, for example, it will be different from when you are controlling airborne transmission, where you will, for example, have to provide the worker with a respirator, for example. And for contact, you know, it's different. You won't be providing that. So it's important to know the route of transmission for that purpose. Once the transmission route has been identified, then you have to also decide on who may be harmed in the workplace. So that will be your worker or your host. So for different workers, because their risk profile differs in different workplaces, you look at the risk occupation. Also noting here that workers may have same job titles, for example. However, their activities can differ. So the main focus should be on the activity. You shouldn't be generalizing for by job title, because exposure may differ by job task. And also when looking at the worker, we need to be focusing also on the high risk groups. In this instance, I'm sure you have all heard of the high risk group to COVID-19 is mostly your workers or people with comorbidities or who are older than 60 years. And I've just listed examples of comorbidities on the slide right at the bottom there. So while doing your risk assessment, also include individual risk assessment, looking at your high risk groups in your workplaces. And duration of exposure has to be taken into consideration as well, because it has been proven that the longer the person is post or is in that area where they conduct their daily tasks, the higher the risk of exposure. So that has to be also taken into consideration. And then other in exposure routes can be semi-indirect. So the hands that are contaminated with the virus, that is why we are advised to always ensure that we implement hand hygiene through hand washing or through hand sanitizing. And then also it can be indirect through equipment and objects that are contaminated, as I've previously mentioned. And in your work environment also, you have to identify high risk areas such as the waiting areas or everywhere where people congregate or there's a group of people. That is where the priority should be when mitigating the risks, and as well as identify the high touch surfaces. Those are areas where we share in the work environment and that are frequently used throughout the day. And I've listed a few examples there at the bottom, which needs to also be cleaned and or disinfected where necessary. So I just want to mention also that risk assessment is requires a multidisciplinary approach.
Apologies, Tikelede. My apologies for interrupting you. There are some comments about the audio being a bit soft. Could you move closer to your microphone? Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ashraf. Is it better now?
It sounds better on my side. Thanks.
Okay. I'll try to bring it a bit closer. So I was saying that risk assessment requires multiple experts because of different speciality. If I can give an example, you need a microbiologist because of the type of agent we're dealing with, who understand the properties and the characteristics of the agent itself. And then for the environment, for example, you need a building engineer or ventilation engineer who will advise on control measures that will be effective when you mitigating in the building, as well as a medical professional for when it comes to health effects when handling the affected workers or infected workers. So one has to ensure that the findings of the risk assessment is recorded so that there is evidence of what has been found and what needs to be done. And it needs to be implemented and reviewed on a regular basis. The Department of Employment and Labor currently recommend that it must be reviewed every 2 years for hazardous biological agent. However, it can be reviewed also even before 2 years, depending on whether there is changes in the building or in the of the equipment or any change that may impact on the health of the worker. And then the risk assessment also needs to be updated on a regular basis. So I'm not gonna go through the in detail on the slide, but just to emphasize that when mitigating, the hierarchy of controls needs to be taken into consideration. So these are the main things to look at or steps to look at. We all know that microorganisms are everywhere, so you cannot eliminate the virus at all because it will be there. However, you can change activities or any procedures in your workplace in order to ensure that you minimize exposure or the chances of transmission between the workers or in the work setting. So for examples there here under substitution, instead of having all staff coming to work, for example, you can rotate staff or have shift works and then or limit the number of workers at work. If others can work at home that doesn't require to be in the offices or in the company, then allow those to work remotely. And then also allow virtual meetings, for example, instead of having face-to-face meetings. Under administration, the employer has to ensure that there are policies in place which are related to COVID-19 management or control. And they must also ensure that the workers are aware of all these policies and also conduct risk assessment, which helps us in identifying the risk in order to prevent workers from being exposed. I've also mentioned the importance of identifying your vulnerable workers because they are more prone to being exposed or to disease as compared to your healthy workers. And then we are all implementing social distance at the moment. By now, I'm sure it's been a year already since we have been with this pandemic. So most of the things we are implementing, such as use of sanitizers and advising the sick workers to stay at home when they are sick, because we don't want them to transmit the disease to other workers or their colleagues. And then it's important to communicate the risk so that the workers know what the employer has put into place to protect them. And as well as promote awareness campaigns to inform and update the workers of what is happening in the workplace and monitor compliance. For engineering and environmental, it's the surface disinfection, of which my colleague will cover in detail in the next presentation. The facilities hand wash or hand hygiene facilities has to be provided to the workers, having barriers or rearranging workstations to ensure that there is safe distance between the workers. And as well as having isolation rooms identified in each workplace for those who will present with symptoms while at work or during screening when entering the workplace, they can be isolated before they are being sent home. And then all promote hands-free devices where you avoid touching surfaces in order to avoid cross-contamination. One of the hierarchy of controls which is unfamiliar or which people are not used to being part of the hierarchy of controls is behavior. We've included this the behavior as part of the hierarchy of controls because it is critical, especially when it comes to COVID-19 or pandemic, because it really depends on us. We can have policies in place, but if we are not implementing or complying, it wouldn't help. And we can have all work practices or guidelines or work instructions of respiratory etiquette and hygiene, donning and doffing of PPE. But if there's no compliance, then it will not serve us the purpose. So it's important to promote behavioral change in the workplace. And lastly is personal protective equipment. So this is where workers are provided with the PPE to protect themselves. So depending on the job, the type of job that the person does, one, and also from doing your risk assessment, it will inform you of when to provide respirators, for example, to a worker or to provide gloves. So we're not giving PPE to everyone in the workplace. Your risk assessment should inform you on who, based on the risks and the tasks that they are doing. But as it stands now, we know that it's compulsory to wear masks in order to minimize the release of droplets into the environment or to our colleagues. And then just to highlight also, PPE does not replace social distancing. Even if with PPE, you still have to maintain safe distance which is 1.5 to 2 meters between the workers, and also ensure that the reusable PPE is cleaned after use and it's dedicated to each person. There shouldn't be sharing of PPE. So the Department of Employment and Labor has categorized exposure risk groups into four. The very high one is classified as those that are conducting aerosol generating procedures or handling COVID-19 samples, or the people under investigation, as well as cases of COVID-19. And mostly those are your healthcare workers and your laboratories. Whereas your high risk category will include healthcare workers, as well as their support personnel. And those are the examples of who is included in this group. And then you get your medium, which is your all settings that have high volume or congestion of people in the environment, or where there is possibility of exposure because there are unknown cases or unknown people that can be infectious. And your last group is your low high risk group. Basically, those are in minimal contact with the COVID-19 cases or undiagnosed people, and they are far from the recommended safe distance. So after conducting risk assessment, it needs to be evaluated in order to implement controls. So you get a semi-quantitative or quantitative risk assessment. Basically, that one will use the risk rating scale. For example, you'll have like your low will be, for example, from 1 to 6 scale, and your medium will be from 7 to 11, and your high will be from 12 to 20. So it depends on really which tool you're using. So you get those, that one where you use your scores to categorize the risk. And then you get the qualitative one, which we are currently focusing on, where you just report those low, medium, high based on the your observations and your rating based on your observations of the severity or the likelihood of exposure and the consequences it can lead to, then you determine where do you rate the risk. For example, in this table, you see on the top there is the likelihood of exposure, and on your left, on my left, is the consequence. So based on your rating there, you'll decide where they cross, and then you'll rate your risk based on that. And then when assigning priority, there are important factors that needs to be considered depending on the priority or the agency of the control measures. You will decide also on the practicality. For example, if your control measures needs a ventilation to be improved, that may take a while because it depends on your suppliers and their availability, or it depends on the resources, if there is money to do that. So when setting the timelines to meet the, or to mitigate, you need to put practical timelines to ensure that you are able to do that. So this is just an example of a tool. I was informed that the initial request came from a construction company and distribution company. So I've selected a few examples based on that, but think about the activities in your work environment if you are outside the construction and distributing companies, and think how you can implement this tool. But basically it's just the generic and basic tool. So activities here, one example is accessing the work site. So while construction workers are accessing the work site, they can be, there's potential exposure because they are all working in groups And there are also visitors that are coming in and customers that are coming in. We all know what the hazard is, and we've discussed the route of transmission as well as the health effects. So while doing risk assessment, you ensure that you first record your baseline controls. These are the controls that you already have in place in your workplace. So if you already have policies, you're using sanitizers, having disinfection procedures in place, you'll record all those here. If you are using a fingerprint scanners for access control, one needs to also think about this. What are the risks? Because people are using fingerprints which can be contaminated, whether the chances of transmission is high. So should you be removing this or disabling them temporarily, or do you have additional measures in place to ensure that there is no cross contamination between the workers that are coming in? So that's something to think about when doing your risk assessment. And your residual controls will be those that you don't have in place. If you haven't done your identification for or risk assessment for vulnerable workers, then you'll put it here. If you are not currently screening your staff, it will be here. If there's no adequate ventilation, or if you haven't staggered times between the workers, because this helps also to minimize congestion. So the fewer the workers, the lesser the chances of transmission. And those that can work remotely, as mentioned, can do that. So now you look at those two columns and decide, okay, who's gonna attend to this? And then you give a deadline on when this should be done. For now, I've rated this very high because of this critical components that needs to be in place already by this time in every setting or work setting. So if you are going to attend to this, then they will move into the baseline controls into the site. So the lesser you have under the residual controls, the lower your risk. So the more you attend to this, then you're going to lower your risk to either medium or low, depending on how quick and how far you go about controlling. So the other activity is transporting of workers and or delivery of material into the site. So who will be affected? Your drivers, because they are transporting workers into the workplace. They are in contact with the potentially infectious source. Also that the transport on itself, the surfaces can be contaminated. And so it's important to ensure you have measures in place while driving the workers, ensure that there's open windows, or rather have less passengers in the car. Or another alternative is to increase your trips. That will be costly, of course, because of consumption of petrol. So find a way that is practical and that can work for the company as well. And for those who deliver materials, ensure that also they clean the material before exchange or before drop off. So I've highlighted here also gloves and signature devices. For gloves, it depends on the type of activity. If a person is just offloading things or materials, that's okay to provide gloves. But if they are going to exchange between people, then that should be considered as well. So depending on your risk assessment, check what entails, what the job entails, and you decide whether to provide gloves. Some activity will require change of gloves in between, which is gonna be a costly exercise. So rather maybe give sanitizers to use between the activity than buying gloves, which can be expensive. So it depends on you and management what they decide. And this, I've added the signature devices because I've seen some deliveries, they will give you this device where you need to use your finger to sign. So that also poses a risk of transmission. Do you really want to use that? And if they are using it, is there a control measure between the users or between customers that they've put in place? Are they wiping the device to ensure that if there is potential contamination that has been cleared? And so as mentioned above, residual controls is what you haven't put in. So hand washing, while doing risk assessment, you're seeing it as a possibility, but do you really, or is it practical to recommend hand washing for this type of activity? While driving, there is no access for basins or any water system. So rather here, you'll opt for sanitizer instead of hand wash. So I'm just indicating some of control measures that you put, ensure that they are practical for the type of job. So another example is having site meetings. There are options for visual meetings, or instead of having a meeting in the room, rather have it in an open space where there is enough ventilation, and ensure also that there is disinfection procedures if it's in a meeting room or a boardroom in your workplace. And also allow maybe only essential personnel to attend the meeting. So those that are really needed in the meeting, instead of having everyone in the meeting, or you can allow the supervisors to come to the meeting and they can feedback to their groups. And then training of staff is almost similar to the site meetings, because there you will also have a group of people. So you ensure you have all measures in place, if you can limit the numbers, so be it, and ensure that there is adequate ventilation as well. Natural ventilation is currently recommended because it's as efficient as mechanical, and we know in most of our buildings, mechanical ventilation is malfunctioning. So rather ensure open windows, and some where may have air cons and fans, but cautions have to be taken here because split air cons, they can be recirculating in the room. So if the air is contaminated, you just circulating contaminated air in the room, which is a higher risk. And the fence also does the same thing. So if it's mechanical ventilation, let's ensure that there is a fresh air supply as well, or rather open windows and door, which is simple and cost effective. So for construction workers, also handling of materials, I've mentioned if you're handling any materials, ensure that there's a disinfection procedures in place. And if there is any waste, also we have to ensure that we have proper waste disposal. We have enough bins. We have enough for disinfection. Some may be using paper towels. Make sure we have enough stock and they are disposed of properly as required. So here, your residual control, it's I'm having two. So the risk rating here will be medium, because disinfection is a critical component when it comes to SARS. But as soon as you have these procedures in place in your baseline controls, then it will lower the risk. So lifting operations also, it is recommended that where possible, mechanical methods be used. So here I just wanted to show the possibility of low risk. If you have most of your control in place, and maybe for lifting operators, it's required that they use site radio in their work. Site radio, yes, it is an equipment that can be potentially contaminated as well. But if you are providing each worker with their radio, then the risk is low. And also ensuring that during shift change, if they are going to hand over the radio, they must just make sure they also clean and decontaminate before handing over to the next worker. So your risk should be low if you have all those controls in place. So these are just general assessment. I just wanted to highlight here For administrative, although it is in the offices, it's not in the plant, we may think the risk is low, but there may be risk as well. So there is risk actually. So when looking at controls here, I wanted to highlight that for administrative, because it's offices, you may need to provide them with sanitizers instead of, because there are no, there's no access to washing basins. And also they don't need gloves because they are in the office, they can use sanitizers. Where possible, those who can do teleworking or remote working, allow them to do so. And they can probably come once in a while in the office just for reporting and for critical meetings. Lunch break duty, it's not directly part of our task, but we are in the workplace and we do take breaks and we do share spaces. So it's important to also ensure that in our tea rooms, we have control measures in place. We can decide on how many people can go at a time. If it's a small tea room, maybe two at a time. If it's bigger, four, depending on your risk assessment, you'll also determine that. If you have a cafeteria on site, that's great because workers don't have to go outside to go and buy food outside where it poses them to the high risk of exposure outside at the shops. And then in the cafeteria, it is recommended that all food must come wrapped and then also probably stagger breaks so that people must not go and gather all together in the cafeteria. And then also provide the gloves for caterers in order to minimize contamination from the hands to the food. And accommodation I've included also for construction workers. We know we also have migrant workers that come to work in our construction industries for whom we provide accommodation for. So the employers who ensure that they have adequate rooms for all of their workers and enough showers and basins for hand hygiene or also for general hygiene, and ensure that their workspaces or their rooms, there's enough ventilation, and have ongoing awareness campaign also on the with regards to the virus, on how it can be transmitted and on how to protect themselves. And lastly, for site inspections, if there is any that needs to happen in the construction place, then we also need to ensure that our inspectors are protected who comes into the environment, because they will be interviewing the supervisors or managers. And they may also come into different areas within the work environment to inspect if there is compliance, so there is potential risk of exposure. So they should also be protected by the employer as required by the legislation. So cleaning, I'm not gonna go through into details. Dr. Charlene is gonna cover this, but basically workers, cleaners are also at risk of exposure because they go into different areas, into our offices, the bathrooms, the tea rooms. So they need to be provided with a glass to protect themselves. But most importantly, cleaners needs to be trained on how to use the disinfectant, because it is important to know how much to dilute with water for it to be effective in killing the virus. And the safety with regards to the use of disinfectant also needs to be trained on that, and so that they know how to protect themselves. So security checks, our securities in our workplace, because they are at the entrances of our buildings. And they come into contact with different people, your contractors, your visitors, your customers. So they also need to be protected. And so there are a few control measures that can be put into place. An example here is instead of giving each visitor or customer a pen and a register to fill in, security must rather fill the register themselves, that minimize transmission or the risk of transmission. And we all know now the rule of no mask, no entry in each building. And then staff rotation of shifts are recommended for the securities. And preferably they must be grouped in teams so that we avoid like broader transmission. At least if there's one infected worker in one team, we know it affects one group and other workers can carry on to come to work. And also for business continuity, it helps to group or to split their groups. And then if there is a function of viewing IDs or at the entrance, then probably they shouldn't be touching the IDs. They must just ask the driver of the ID and just check and write everything. So the more you try and identify where you can break the chain of infection, the better. So when conducting health risk assessment, there are common mistakes that people make. They think it's just a once-off process or just a tick box exercise. And as Gabby mentioned, risk assessment is a continuous process. And it changes over time, so you need to keep checking and reviewing it. And then workers must also be involved because they may provide you with valuable information on how to control the risk as well, because they understand their work better. And then they must also be encouraged to report when they experience any symptoms or if they have identified anything that may be posing a risk in their work environment. And risk assessment must be reviewed and recorded all the time, because when we go to some workplaces, we find out that their risk assessment is outdated because it was done once and filed and forgotten about. And then sometimes risk assessment, especially for hazardous biological agents, is not done fully due to lack of a competency of staff that has to do the risk assessment, and also limited knowledge, for example, about the agent itself. That's why I highlighted that you need a multidisciplinary approach. So, and then also I've mentioned that the hierarchy of control has to be taken into consideration. So risk must be communicated to the workers, highlighting the hazards, the risks, and the health effects that the exposure can lead to, and what the employer has put in to protect them. Employer needs to be involved also because they need to ensure that their policies are updated and implemented, and also to provide resources in order to mitigate the risks or assisting with implementing control measures. Most importantly, involve all committees in the workplace so that we are all having one vision, one goal, and then we achieve whatever we need to achieve and avoid duplication of things as well. Because when everyone is involved, we know where we're lacking and where to improve, and include health and safety reps as well as trade unions as well. Occupational health is important because they are looking after your workers. IPC, we're ensuring that there is infection prevention and control policies and implementation in place. When necessary, external advisor may be sought, especially when it comes to hazardous biological agents, as I've mentioned. So in conclusion, we have to anticipate the risks. We identify, we record and review on a regular basis, and not forgetting to conduct risk assessment for individuals, those with vulnerabilities, and ensure that we implement practical mitigation strategies following the hierarchy of controls. And all staff must be vigilant and be informed, and employer must ensure that policies are communicated effectively to both the workers and to the public. And then the risk assessment needs to be updated with changes and be communicated to all involved, as mentioned in the previous slides. And most importantly, to consider indirect risks, because with COVID-19, we've put measures into places. We are making rearrangements and changes where they can also affect us indirectly, like having your barriers and changing the work seating arrangements may have ergonomical risks, and using of disinfectants and sanitizers may lead to exposure of workers, which may lead to respiratory or skin allergies, for example, and Legionella, which may be from example when the buildings were shut down, the water became stagnant, and then it could lead to replication of the organism in the water system. So we need to ensure that we also do our water risk assessment, ensure that we maintain the water systems by flushing weekly and ensuring that they are disinfected on a regular basis. So you need to call in a specialist on that to assist you with that. And because of COVID also, working at home, people have been isolated. It affects their mental health, and even at work, just the anxiety of or the fear of being exposed can affect our mental health. And lastly, business risk also, because indirectly it can be affected if workers get sick and they stay at home and production is halted, that can affect the business as well. So, and then lastly, we must ensure that we enforce all the measures or procedures we have in place and ensure that we monitor to see that whatever we put in place is working as it should. With that, I would like to thank you.
Thank you very much. That was Dikeledi Matuka dealing with risk assessment tools. And Dikeledi is from our immunology and microbiology section here at the NIOH. Our next speaker is Dr. Charlene Andreas. We're running a bit behind time, but we will use some of the question answer time at the end for Dr. Andreas to complete her presentation. It deals with cleaning and disinfecting in different workplace settings, including storage and transportation. This was one of the special requests from I think it was, as Dikeledi mentioned, the chemical industry, as well as the construction industry. I think there may be some of our workplaces where chemicals like hand sanitizer is dealt with in bulk, probably for in manufacturing, storage and transportation and moving and so on. And so therefore, I'm very glad that Dr. Charlene Andreas has agreed to share her knowledge and experience with us. So thank you for joining us. Whilst the slides are showing and the audio is being checked, by a brief introduction, Dr. Charlene Andreas has a PhD in molecular medicine and hematology from Wits University. She obtained a PhD from Wits University, that's a repetition. She has worked in the toxicology and biochemistry section at the NIH as a medical scientist since 2010, with her fields of interest being particle toxicology and nanotoxicology. She's also a member of the Toxicology South Africa, Society of South Africa, let me repeat that, the Toxicology Society of South Africa, TOXA, as well as the South African Council for Natural Scientific Professions, SACNASP. Dr. Andreas has also compiled the cleaning and disinfection guideline document, which is currently available on the NIH website. This document provides guidelines on the proper cleaning and disinfection guidelines required when COVID-19 positive cases have been identified in the workplace. Dr. Andreas has also provided training in the form of virtual presentations during the training sessions provided NIH COVID-19 webinar series. So with great pleasure, I'm going to hand you over to Dr. Charlene Andreas. Thank you, Charlene.
Thanks, Ashraf. Tell me, can you hear me well?
Perfectly, quite clearly. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so I would like to start off. Let me just see. The presentation isn't moving. Um, Okay, so it's not going to the next slide.
Would you like our colleague in the IT department perhaps to share the slides? Oh, there we go.
It seems like it's working now. There was a bit of a delay.
Please.
Okay, thanks, Ashraf. Okay, so I will start off first with common questions that we have received in the past and which I have answered in detail in previous webinars. So you are more than welcome to go and have a look at these past presentations that are now currently on the NIOH website. But for the purposes of this presentation today, I will just provide a short answer to some of these questions before I move on to the actual information that I need to share. Okay, so first of all is what exactly is deep cleaning? Now, this is thorough cleaning with soap, followed by disinfection with ethanol or JIC of all likely contaminated surfaces. Now, the second question that we have received quite often is why is fogging as a deep cleaning method not recommended? And the short answer for this is that it is often not conducted correctly according to specific guidelines. And this may thus increase unnecessary health risks. The third question is, should a business be closed for deep cleaning when a COVID positive case is identified? And the short answer for this is no. The whole business does not have to be closed if contaminated areas can be separated from the rest of the building. Okay, so another question that we do get quite often is, should only external cleaning companies conduct deep cleaning? And is a certificate of cleaning needed? And the short answer for this is no. Existing in-house cleaners may conduct deep cleaning provided that they are trained properly and that they are given the correct PPE. And then also no, the Department of Health does not require a certificate of cleaning. And I am providing a link to the direct source of the document that has been provided by the Department of Health, in which they specifically state or give the statement that they do not require a certificate of cleaning. Another question that we do get quite often is when and how should certain items be cleaned and disinfected? For example, how should carpets be cleaned, vehicles be cleaned, etc. And I am referring you here to the link of the cleaning guideline document that is currently available on the NIOH website. And then lastly, do requirements for cleaning and disinfection differ in different workplaces? And the short answer for this is definitely yes. So in this slide, I am providing the links that would show you exactly how to clean in healthcare work settings, non-healthcare work settings, in specific work settings dealing with a lot of documents, files and paperwork, as well as in schools. Okay, so now moving on to common questions that we have received recently, and that is, first of all, are there any recent changes in the directives from the Department of Health or the Department of Employment and Labor regarding cleaning and disinfection of workplaces? And for this, the answer is no. So the documents that have been provided by these two departments last year in 2020 are still valid today. There haven't been any recent changes with regards to cleaning and disinfection of workplaces. Okay, so now I will be moving on to answering the other common questions that we have received recently, and that is, how should sanitizers, disinfectants be properly handled? How should they be properly stored? How should they be properly transported? And then lastly, is it safe to keep hand sanitizers in hot vehicles? Okay, so now these questions are quite valid. Since recently, we have been seeing a lot of news articles popping up where they link fires and explosions to ethanol or hand sanitizers. And as you can see with one of these pictures, this was published on the 16th of April. And it specifically says that 30,000 liters of ethanol catch fire at a factory in Centurion. Okay, so first of all, for the safe use of sanitizers and disinfectants, always refer to the safety data sheet, or SDS for short. And this has formerly been this is formerly known as the material safety data sheet or product safety data sheet. Now, these SDSs will differ depending on the composition of the sanitizer or disinfectant. So now, hand sanitizers generally contain 60 to 70% ethanol or isopropyl alcohol, and surface disinfectants generally contain hypochlorite based solutions, for example, bleach or jet. So therefore, it is really important to always refer to the correct SDS. There isn't one universal SDS addressing all sanitizers or disinfectants. So therefore, you have to specifically refer to the SDS for your specific product. Okay, so now South Africa has its own regulations for hazardous chemical agents, and this was promulgated in terms of Section 43 of the Occupational Health and Safety Act. So now Section 414A of the regulations for hazardous chemical agents specifically states that an SDS shall be provided by the manufacturer or importer to any person requesting it. And this was quite discussed in quite detail in the previous webinar hosted by the NIOPH. And I have provided two links of the presentations from the Department of Employment and Labour if you would like to find out more about SDSs or the regulations for hazardous chemical agents. So in short, SDSs must always be publicly available. And if it is not possible to get it online, please insist on getting the SDS from the company supplying the sanitizer or disinfectant. Okay, so now it is mandatory for safety data sheets to always consist of these 16 sections. And I will be discussing most of these sections in detail by giving an example of an SDS that was provided by Sasol. And this is freely available online, so you can have a look later on if you want. So now section one should always refer to the identification of the substance being addressed in the SDS. So in this case, the trade name of the product is the sanitizer WHO recommended hand rub formulation, and the synonyms for this product is hand sanitizer or WHO made hand sanitizer. So you can also see in section one, they provide specific and direct contact details for the company providing the SDS. So that means that you can contact the company directly if you have any specific questions regarding the product or regarding the SDS. So now with section two. Section two always deals with the hazards identification of the product. And as you can see in this case, for this sanitizer, the hazard statement is that it is highly flammable, liquid and vapor, and it causes serious eye irritation. And you can also see that this is represented by the hazard pictograms. So it is flammable and an irritant. And section three deals with the composition or information of the ingredients of the product. So you can see here clearly that the product contains mostly ethanol, about 80% of this. And it is this ethanol that has the flammable and irritant hazard statements. And you can see with the other ingredients in this product, they do not have hazard statements at the concentrations that they are provided with in this product. Okay, so now I'm just quickly jumping to section nine of the SDS. And section nine specifically deals with the physical and chemical properties. So now I would like to draw your attention to this flashpoint of the product. And this flashpoint is 17.5 degrees Celsius. Now, the flashpoint of a liquid is defined as the lowest temperature at which a substance generates a sufficient amount of vapor to form a vapor-air mixture that can be ignited. Now, I'm introducing this term here because I will be discussing or referring to it later in my presentation. Okay, so now moving on to section four, the SDA should always address first aid measures if you have been accidentally exposed via inhalation, skin contact, eye contact, as well as ingestion. Section five will always address the firefighting measures. So for this specific product, the suitable extinguishing media is water spray, dry powder, and foam. And then section six will deal with the accidental release measures. So they do mention here, ensure adequate ventilation, keep away from sources of ignition, and no smoking is allowed in the presence of this product. So they also give specific instructions on how to deal with spills, whether they are small or large. And for small spills, they say that you have to wear the correct PPE, use absorbent paper to absorb the spill, collect the paper and seal it in drums for disposal. And then for large spills, they say shut off all sources of ignition, clear area of unprotected personnel, increase ventilation, cover with absorbent material. So this could be any inert material or powder, sand or soil. Vacuum or sweep up the absorbent material and then always use a spark-free shovel. Okay, so now section seven deals with the handling and storage of the product. And again, they mention here, keep away from sources of ignition and static electricity charge, which might cause ignition of vapors. And then also keep storage containers tightly closed in cool, well-ventilated places. And then section 10 deals with the stability and reactivity of the product. They say avoid strong sunlight for prolonged periods, avoid heat, open flames, and avoid storing the product with oxidizing agents, reducing agents, acids, and bases. So now moving on to section 14, this deals with the transport information of the product. And what I like about this section is that it deals with transport of the product by road, by rail, by water, as well as by air. And that is what each of these sections represent. So now for each of these sections, you will see that there is a unique UN number assigned to the product. So all dangerous goods are assigned a UN number according to their hazard classification and composition. As you can see here, this product has been given a class of three, which means that it is a flammable liquid. And then it is also assigned a packaging group. So in this case, it is 2 and F1. Now, this also is being given based on the properties of the product. So in this case, F1 means that it is for all flammable liquids having a flash point of or below 60 degrees. So as I've mentioned before, our product has a flash point of 17.5 degrees. Okay, so now in terms of transportation, I would recommend you going to the document of the South African National Road Traffic Act 93 of 1996. And this includes all provisions for the road transport of dangerous goods as listed by the South African National Standards 10 to 28. And I'm also providing the links to these documents if you want to go and have a look. But then I would also like to refer you to a website, which is the online ADR book. Now, what's nice about this website is that you could just enter the unique UN number of your product in the search column or the search box, and it would bring up an interactive table, something similar to this. And as you can see that I have entered our unique UN number, which is 1170. And this table shows exactly how to transport this dangerous goods. And it is interactive in terms of you can click on any of these codes and numbers, and it will tell you exactly the precise definition of the code, as well as the regulations that are associated with that specific code. And you can see that this table It covers absolutely everything from about the limited and accepted quantities of the product, packaging instructions, portable tanks and bulk containers if you're dealing with the product in bulk, vehicle for tank carriage. It definitely covers everything. And what I like about this is that it is interactive. Okay, so now moving on to fire safety. Now, as I mentioned before, ethanol, which is generally the main ingredient in sanitizers, is flammable. So due to the increased demand, wineries and distilleries are assisting with producing ethanol for sanitizers. Now, of course, this would lead to an increased flammable risk. And therefore, it is really important for these wineries and distilleries, as well as any other company producing ethanol, to conduct risk assessment or at least revise the current risk assessments to identify the additional potential hazards posed by ethanol. Okay, so now in this case for fire safety, I refer to the South African General Safety Regulations, and the section 4 of these regulations specifically deals with the use and storage of flammable liquids. So now they do say here that the employer shall always prevent vapor from any flammable liquid to generate to such an extent that it constitutes an actual or potential fire or explosion hazard. So they also say that the employer must allow adequate ventilation to remove vapor. And in this case, there are specific recommendations for air speed, depending on the design of the air supply and extraction mechanism used. Like, for example, the air speed should be above 0.5 meter per second if the air supply and extraction mechanism is horizontal, etc. So the employer should also allow installation of proper fire-resistant ducts, trunks, and enclosures. And the fire-resistant material should be at least 2 hours from any room, cabinet, or enclosure. So now we do have specific minimum standards for fire safety cabinets that we have to refer to. And this is available on the SABS website, and this is specifically for fire safety cabinets. And then also the employer shall always provide respirators, masks, or breathing apparatus as and when required. The employer shall also allow installation of correct cabinets. Now, this is specifically cabinets for spraying of flammable liquids. So in this case, again, there are specific recommendations for air speed depending on the design of the cabinet. So for example, if you have a spray cabinet with an open face of less than 1 square meter, then the average air speed of this cabinet should be above 1 meter per second. Okay, the employer shall also allow installation of adequate number of doors and windows. So if you have an area with a floor, or if you have a floor area of above 20 meters squared, then at least 2 separate entrances at opposite ends of the room is required, which shall be fitted with door openings, with doors opening outwards, and that cannot be locked. Also, for this size of floor area, at least 1 inspection window of strengthened and shatterproof glass that cannot be opened should be installed. So they are quite specific in the recommendations that they require for areas dealing with bulk storage of flammable liquids. Okay, and then the last 2 sections, they do say here that the employer shall allow provisions of adequate notices, and these notices are specifically preventing fire, flames, or naked light, or anything which may generate static electricity, or any other thing which may ignite a flammable liquid or its vapor, should be added in and around the facilities. Okay, and then lastly, the employer must allow efficient firefighting equipment in suitable locations in and around every building dealing with flammable liquids. Okay, so they are, again, specific of what they require. Okay, so now coming to a question that we are now recently receiving quite a lot, and that is it safe to keep hand sanitizers in hot vehicles? So for this question, I specifically refer to the information that has been published by the US National Fire Protection Association, and I have also provided the link to the specific webpage. And in this webpage, the NFPA says that at room temperature and above, hand sanitizer can ignite if met with an ignition source like a flame. But many people misinterpret this to mean that it can ignite purely from the heat inside a hot vehicle, and this is false. So they also say that when a liquid's flash point is reached, which in our case is 17.5 degrees, the liquid starts to give off enough vapors to ignite in air. But yet again, those vapors still need to be met with an ignition source to catch fire. So this is an ignition temperature is also needed in addition to the flash point. So the ignition temperature is usually, this is now the ignition temperature for ethanol or hand sanitizers is in the excess of above 300 degrees Celsius. And they have shown that vehicles sitting in the scorching summer sun won't get above 100 degrees Celsius. So it is not possible for hand sanitizers to ignite simply from just the heat inside a hot vehicle. So they do say here that sanitizers are flammable, but it can only ignite if a flame is introduced. So that is exactly why they say avoid smoking, avoid dealing with open flames. Although they do mention here that leaving small amounts of hand sanitizers in your car does not pose a significant fire risk. It should not be kept in vehicles or hot vehicles because high temperatures can lower its disinfectant ability. And with this, they mean that high temperatures lead to evaporation of ethanol, and that would lower the effectiveness of the hand sanitizer. Okay, and we have reached the end. That is it. Thank you.
Thank you. That was Dr. Charlene Andreos dealing with cleaning and disinfecting in different workplace settings and obviously adopting quite a good approach there in dealing with some of the most commonly asked questions that have come through our webinars as we've dealt with this topic and as the knowledge has unfolded in how to deal with the chemical component and generally the risk assessment tools within the COVID-19 epidemic nationally and globally, the pandemic. So thank you very much. We have a few minutes left, about 7 minutes. I'm gonna ask our colleagues, the three presenters, if there were any key trends that they've seen in the question answer box. I see there's still six questions open. I'm going to ask also Dr. Andreas just to have a quick look there at the questions that have been added, especially during her session. And I'll start with Gabriel. Gabby, your sense of the key questions that you've come across in the question answer box, the trends there, I mean, are there any specific key comments you want to make? And we have about 2 to 3 minutes per presenter. If you want to go for it first, Gabby.
Hi, Ashraf. I must say there weren't many questions related specifically to my presentation. We haven't seen a lot of questions, I think, in general. I would just say maybe one of the questions about conducting the health risk assessment, and like I said, you know, it doesn't necessarily have to be a professional person. It can be any person. but provided that he's familiar with all those things that we listed in my presentation, including knowing the process of how to do a risk assessment, familiar with the regulations, familiar with the topic, which is SARS-CoV-2, which causes COVID-19. And also, again, stressing the fact that it's an ongoing process. The regulations are not very prescriptive about those things, but we really sometimes need to apply our common sense and say, you know, if there are changes in the work environment or if we see incidents, you know, then we need to look at our risk assessment. Yeah, I think that's mainly from my side. Thanks a lot, Ashraf.
Thank you for that. That was Gabby, and I'm going to quickly just hand over to Dikeledi. If you could just unmute your microphone. I mean, are there any key observations in the questions that you've seen? Any final comments from you about two or three minutes on your side, Dikeledi?
Okay, thank you, Ashraf. One is the one that Gabby addressed on who should be conducting risk assessment. And the other one was a question on breathalyzers, whether they are classified as aerosol generating procedures as well. So I've answered it on the Q&A box. Basically, the aerosol generating procedures, that references to the procedures that are conducted in hospitals by healthcare workers who are treating COVID-19 patients. So breathalyzers are not, does not fall in that category. However, they can pose a risk because workers, I understand, have to blow into the devices, and therefore there's a chance of spitting or of a release of droplets from the saliva that can pose a risk. So people who are using breathalyzers must also conduct risk assessment depending on the device they are using, whether it's contained or enclosed or it's open. The risk will really depend on that. The area where it's done, is it in the small room or is it done outside? So all those factors have to be taken into consideration. And also the current procedures that are in place to ensure between the workers what is the decontamination or disinfection process between the workers and the safe distance and so on. So that's basically what I saw.
Thank you for that, Dikeledi. We have about 2 minutes or so left. Charlene, could I invite you just to share your final thoughts? I know that you are also currently typing and answering Vuseleseleli's, our Kovane's answer question there. I'm going to, in the meantime, while you perhaps make some comments, ask our colleagues, Dikeledi and Gabby, just to answer some of the questions that's remaining. There's still some open question answer questions there. Over to you, Charlene. Final comments, observations. Please proceed.
Okay, thanks, Ashraf. So I see now with the questions, most people are asking about, is the canting of sanitizers from big containers into small containers allowed? And definitely, yes, this is allowed and this is actually recommended. Now, there are specific instructions on how to decant properly. And if I'm not mistaken, the instructions for this is available in the South African General Safety Regulations, Section 4. So I would definitely recommend these people to go to that specific document and have a look at Section 4, specifically dealing with decanting of sanitizers. So I see that is mostly the questions domineering or the chats for now. And for now, that is it. Thank you, Ashraf. I will still ask these questions.
Yes, thank you very much. I will ask my colleague to keep those questions open so it can all be answered before closing the question answer box. Thank you, Charlene, for that. That sort of brings us to the closure of our session today. There have been quite a number of complimentary comments in the chat box for all of our presenters, particularly also the last presentation. There have been questions about will the presentations be shared? Yes, I've just posted for you, as that's for you as attendees, on the chat box, the standard formulated reply of the NIH that all of our presentations, the recordings of these webinars, will all be uploaded on our website. The website is zero-rated by the major, by all of the mobile service providers and a internet service provider. So if you do go to our website using those service providers, you will not be charged data. It is zero-rated. So on our website would be all of the recordings, the presentations, as well as other very useful resources, and that is www.nioh.ac.za, www.nioh.ac.za. Please visit the website and you'll find a host of resources there. You'd also heard Dr. Charlene Andreos mention in her presentations, like the other colleagues, indicating links to specific resources on our website. The YouTube channel also has the full recordings of our webinars conducted since March of 2020. And I think this is our 71st webinar in the COVID-19 webinar series. So thank you all of you for attending. There are some questions that I will just quickly have a look at in the chat box that may need some immediate answering. And my colleagues are encouraging to just ensure that they answer the remainder of the questions in the question and answer box, and those are the presenters. So in conclusion, thank you very much to Dr. Tanusha Singh, who has done the welcome on behalf of the NIH and the NIH's COVID-19 Occupational Health Outbreak Response Team, the COVID-19 Award Team, as well as our three presenters, very capable presenters. That's Gabriel Mizan from our Occupational Hygiene section, dealing with the principles of workplace health risk assessments. Dikeledi Matuka from the Immunology and Microbiology section, dealing with the risk assessment tools, and Dr. Charlene Andreos from our Toxicology and Biochemistry section here at the NIH, dealing with cleaning and disinfecting in different workplace settings. That includes storage and transportation, and she's just dealt at the end with decanting when you pour chemicals into other containers. And so thank you, everybody, for joining us today. We will be seeing on our next webinar, and that webinar would be dealing with mental health resilience during this period, obviously, of COVID. This is a critical topic, and this webinar will be happening next week, Tuesday. You would be receiving the invitation today. If you've not received the invitation to our mental health webinar topic for next week, Tuesday, please email info@nih.ac.za. info@nioh.ac.za. And on that note, thank you very much, everybody, for attending. We will see you on our next webinar. Goodbye.